Hello, my lovely friends. My name is Ava, and today I'm going to talk about romance books that have disability and chronic illness representation in them. This is my sixth romance recommendation video that has disability representation, so be sure to go check out my other videos. They're going to be linked down below, so you can get even more recommendations if you have not seen those videos yet. These are probably my favorite romance recommendation videos, romance trope videos to film, because I am a part of this community and I just want to spread the love for people out there who are like me, who don't see themselves typically in romance novels or in books in general, honestly. So we have a wide range of representation in here. I believe we have some mobility aid users, some cane users. There are some speechless characters, some amputees, and a few books that have chronic illness representation as well. And I also want to preface, I do not have any of the conditions and or disabilities that we're going to be talking about today in this video. I do have recommendations in previous videos that have conditions and or disabilities that I have, so I can speak to the representation on those, but I personally don't have any condition or disabilities that we are going to be talking about today. And so if you are part of the community that has said disability and or chronic illness and you feel like it is not good rep, please let me know in the comments. I never want to recommend a book that has poor representation. I've done my research, and from what I can tell by reviews and everything, these books do have good rep. But I want to hear from the community, and I want to hear from people who have these conditions and disabilities. So please don't be afraid to comment down below or reach out to me on Instagram to help me become aware, please, because I do not want to recommend a book ever that has poor rep in it. So let's get started. The first book that we're going to be talking about is Kingdom Fall by A. Zavarelli. This is actually a mafia romance. It has some of my favorite tropes in this book. You have mafia, single dad, nanny. Alessio in here is our mafia lead, mafia man, and he is in need of a nanny for his six-year-old son, so he ends up hiring Natalia. Natalia has experienced a lot of traumatic things in her life. You're not really privy to that while you're reading it. You're trying to figure out what happened to her throughout the whole span of the book. The trauma that she faced and the things she's experienced left her heavily scarred and with vocal cord paralysis, so she is not able to speak. So things get a little bit complicated, obviously, when Alessio and Natalia start having feelings for each other while she is his son's nanny. But then on top of that, both Alessio and Natalia are hiding very important things. I really liked this book because I didn't really anticipate many of the things that they were hiding, because there are things as a reader you're not really privy to either. And so I was kind of on the edge of my seat trying to figure out, what is this person hiding? What is that person hiding? This is a great mafia romance book. It's also a standalone, which I feel like is rare in mafia romances. Normally they're interconnected into series, or it builds off of other books, you know? Natalia's journey in here, wow. It was very interesting, like, reading about her and learning about her throughout the whole entire story. You are not aware of the whole time what happened to her, what caused vocal cord paralysis, like, how did she get to this point, why is she so heavily scarred, what caused her trauma. Reading about her journey, heartbreaking and very traumatic. And so please be aware of the trigger warnings in here. I do have them listed, so I'll read them out for you. Blood, gore, torture, beatings, kidnapping, and graphic depictions of violence. This is a mafia romance, so just be aware of that. But I really loved Natalia, and Alessio grew on me slowly because he's a very gruff and grumpy and closed off man. But man, Natalia really, really opens his heart. Next, I have Shattered Sea by Catherine Cowles. This has chronic illness representation in here. Our heroine, Lakin, in here deals with chronic pain after a car accident. This is the romance between Lakin and Bowden. This is book four in the Tattered and Torn series, so you've met Lakin in the previous one, but you can honestly read this book as a standalone. I think you should read it in order just because, like, you've met some of the characters in previous books. And so this is actually kind of like a celebrity romance. Bowden in here is a very famous actor, and he decides to go to this very small town the series takes place in, Wolf Gap, to kind of like escape his celebrity lifestyle, but also do some research on a certain ranch that's in the town, because he really wants to make a movie surrounding a character like the man he's going to be shadowing. So while he's in this very small town, he is walking through town and he just sees this beautiful photograph in this gallery, like through the display window, and he's just staring at it and is like totally entranced by it. He decides to go in to the gallery, and there he meets Lakin, who kind of is the manager of it. And the two of them are very attracted to each other and very intrigued right from the get-go. The two of them are getting to know one another and kind of falling for each other, but then the car accident Lakin was in that took her boyfriend's life in high school, someone is out to kill the people who survived that car crash, like all of her friends that survived it. So this is a romantic suspense, which aren't really my favorite, but I really did enjoy that part of this book, which is saying a lot because I normally don't like that. The chronic pain in here that Lagan experiences is own voices. Brie and I actually got to do a little interview with Catherine Cowles for our Chronically Courageous live show. This was the first book that we picked for her book club back in 2022. And Catherine let us know that this book is own voices. Catherine experienced kind of a similar experience where she was in an accident when she was younger that caused her to have chronic pain. And the chronic pain representation in here, fantastic. I deal with a lot of chronic pain due to what I experienced with my chronic illness, and I related to Lagan so hard. One quote that I really related to is when Bowden and Lagan are talking and she's sitting in an uncomfortable chair. There are certain chairs, many other chronically ill and disabled people will know or relate to this. There are certain chairs that really hurt our body. And so Lagan for a while has been sitting in a chair that doesn't have a back to it, which is something I cannot deal with either. So it kind of flares up her pain. And Bowden is like, well, why didn't you tell me? We could have like moved seats. Like you didn't have to sit in a chair. And so she responds by saying, sometimes I don't want everyone around me to have to make concessions because my body can't keep up like the rest of yours. We'd rather suffer in silence than deal with the pity or the looks or the thoughts about us and our bodies. So I really related to this one and I need more people to pick it up because the chronic illness rep was just so good. Next, I have Plain Love by Avery Kingston. This is a little short novella and I ended up getting this at Wanderlust. Carrie from Booked for Romance, she was talking about this book and how much she wanted it when we were waiting in line to like go into the signing, and she told me what it was about and I was like, sold, I'm getting it. I'm going with you, Carrie. We're going right to that table. This is about Xavier and Lainey. So Lainey and Xavier don't know it yet, but they are actually on a plane going to the same destination wedding to be, I believe, one of the groomsmen and the bridesmaid for the wedding. They both have a role in the wedding. They just don't know each other, but they sit on the plane next to each other. Xavier gets on the plane first because he is a wheelchair user. He gets like priority boarding. And so he gets to sit on the plane first, and the heroine in here sits next to him. And they have an amazing discussion and conversation and are really like flirting with each other and getting to know one another on this plane. But she doesn't know that he's a wheelchair user, and he doesn't know how to like tell her because she can't see his wheelchair because he's sitting on the plane. And so he's like grappling with like, how do I tell this woman? It's kind of awkward to just like blurt it out, you know? And then it goes from there. There's like more going on in here, but this was a really cute and sweet little novella. I got to talk with Avery Kingston at her booth, and she's such a lovely woman. She makes sure to have like some sort of disability rep in every single one of her books because her husband is a veteran. So she really wants to represent vets in that way. And so the hero in here is a vet, because she was talking about how a lot of vets come back to the real world with certain disabilities and chronic illnesses that the world is not like prepared to accommodate to them. And so she wants to shine a light on those people and make their love stories happen, you know? So I really enjoyed this. I loved the representation of a wheelchair user in here. And there's just some really good lines in here too. Like, I think the heroine is overhearing some girls like gossiping about him because he's a groomsman. And they're like, can you believe someone like, they let someone special be a groomsman in this wedding. And she's like, why would you call someone special? It's called being disabled. Like, it's disabled. And so I really liked that because that shows like disabled is not a bad word. It's not a bad word. You can use the word disabled. Don't ever use the word special. My word. Next, I have Broken Whispers by Neva Altaj. This was one of my favorite books that I read last year. I adore this one. This one's about Mikhail and Bianca. They are put in an arranged marriage to align their mafia families. Bianca is this beautiful ballerina who has to kind of end her career short because she was in a car accident a few years ago with her family, and she was the only one that got seriously injured. She suffered a like back injury that left her with the inability to like keep up her dancing career, and she also damaged her vocal cords to where it is so painful for her to talk. And so she learned how to communicate via ASL, and she doesn't speak anymore because of it. So she ends up getting married to Mikhail for alliance reasons, to align their mafia families. He is from the Russian mafia and she doesn't know it yet. But Mikhail already knows who Bianca is because he's kind of obsessed with her and has been pining after her. She is a ballerina in the local like ballet, and he would go and see every single one of her performances because he was totally obsessed with her and entranced by her. This is about Mikhail and Bianca learning how to become a married couple. And it's honestly a little awkward at first because you're getting married to someone you don't know. You're living with someone you don't know. So it goes through like the little awkward stages of not knowing someone at first and then slowly, slowly falling in love with them. I just thought this was really great representation when it came to a character who was speechless. And also, I do want to mention, just by the way, we are like the correct terminology to use is probably like speechless, a character who does not speak, instead of the other word that people primarily use to start with an M, you know? That word I have learned from people in the community, that word is offensive and not culturally like appropriate to say. So be sure not to use that word in your vocabulary anymore. So I did not know this until someone made me aware. So just so you know, like speechless or character who cannot speak is probably the more okay thing to say now, you know, like the better thing to say, obviously, because you do not want to insult or hurt anyone in that community, obviously. Anyway, I just want to say I really enjoyed this book, and I feel like Neval Taj did a great job at representing people in this community really well, or so I've heard. Next, I have Finding Jean Kelly by Tori Jean. I honestly can't believe that this was this author's debut book because it was just so good. It was so good. This is Own Voices rep for endometriosis, and I really loved the rep in here. I really enjoyed it. And Crystal from Crystal's Bookish Life, I love her. She also has endo, and she absolutely adores this book and really loves the representation, so I trust Crystal with my whole stinking heart. I love how she got to read about a book that like fully encompasses what she has been through and really just made her feel seen. Like, I love that for Crystal so much. I love you, Crystal. And so I hope that this book can also be kind of a mirror for those who also have endometriosis. So if you want to pick up a book with amazing endo rep, look no further. Pick this one up, please. This is the romance between Evie and Liam. They grew up together, and in high school, the two of them really want to be more than just friends. But then Liam kind of leaves Evie high and dry. He kind of teases her for what could have been, and she is not happy with him. She doesn't want anything to do with him, honestly, and has not liked him for years. Like, they have been kind of like enemies a little bit, or kind of like frenemies of a sort. They're both grown adults now. Evie now lives in Paris, where she really wants to open up a bakery. That's like her big dream in life, is to open up a bakery. Her best friend ends up coming to France to come visit with her, and he ends up bringing Liam with him. Okay, and Evie's like, why is Liam here? What is going on? And long story short, the two of them have to fake date for certain reasons, and things kind of come to surface as to what happened to them in high school, why Liam acted the way he did, why Evie's acting the way that she did. And I love just the baking in here, the chronic illness representation, the discussion of chronic illnesses. There are a few trigger warnings in here, so I thought I would let you know what they are. Parental gaslighting / passive aggressive bullying, discussions of infertility and chronic pain, obviously. This book is amazing at discussing chronic illnesses and chronic pain and everything, so I thought I would mention one amazing quote that I loved. This one says, because a lot of the time we measure success in forever, but with my disease, I've had to learn to have success in fleeting moments, or else what is the point of anything? I feel like a lot of us who deal with chronic pain and chronic illnesses have those moments and feel that way. So I really related to that, and I think everyone needs to pick up this book because it was just so good. Next, I have Undone by the Ex-Con by Talia Hibbert. This is a second book in a series, but it can totally be read as a standalone. The characters don't really pop up in the first book, so take with that what you will. At the beginning of this book, Lizzie is diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, and it completely changes her life. She decides to quit her dancing career because her body is not able to withstand it really anymore, and she's devastated, but she decides to still incorporate dance into her life. She decides to become a dancing instructor. So she's hired by a family friend to teach dance to his 3 daughters. However, that man has some ulterior motives. He starts to blackmail the heroine in order to get her to do something for him. He wants her to seduce one of his clients named Isaac, who is an ex-con. He is a writer, and he wants to kind of like get the inside scoop on his book and his life, and to kind of just out him for not being a great person. But Isaac actually is a great person. Lizzie is not for this, but she's trying to save her brother. He's blackmailing her with information about her brother, and she does not want that to get out because she doesn't want her brother to get hurt. Lizzie obviously does not want to do this. And then she learns, while she gets to know Isaac, how amazing of a man he is. And so she is so devastated that she has to do something like this. And the two of them start like falling for each other. There's obviously this hidden secret between the two, so just be aware of that. So the representation in here is type 1 diabetes, and I thought that Talia Hibbert did a great job at that representation. And I know I've heard from some of my viewers that they would love to see this rep in more books, and so look no further. Next, I have Love Blushed by Evie Mitchell. This is the second book in the All Access series. First one, I think I've recommended the first one. That one's not my type. And so this one's about not my types, the heroine from that book, her best friend. This is a second chance romance between Link and Annie. They were together in high school, and you don't know why, but throughout the book, you're trying to learn why the two of them kind of called it quits after high school, and they didn't really end on amicable terms. Annie is not a big fan of Link, but the two of them both have these businesses that are gonna go under if they don't team up. So Annie runs a toilet paper company. She has Crohn's disease, and there are certain toilet papers out there that really don't make you feel good down there, that kind of hurt. And so she wants to make toilet paper that is going to be good for those who end up having to use the bathroom a lot, like people with Crohn's disease. But she's trying to find a supplier, I think is the right term, someone who can make the actual toilet paper. And Link and his brother just got the holding of their father's paper factory, and they're trying to figure out, oh, what product can we make in this factory? And if they don't find out soon, they will go under. So he learns about Annie's problem. He puts out this proposal and she's like, fine, I have no other option. And so the two of them have a lot of tension. once they get together, they finally are able to talk about what happened to them all those years ago. The discussion of chronic illnesses in here, so relatable, so relatable. I don't have Crohn's disease, but I have celiac disease, and we have similar symptoms. I just loved Annie and how persevering and how much she like took hold of her chronic illness and just like shouted loud and proud about it. I loved this one. Next, I have an alien romance. This is The Koi Master by Amanda Milo. This is the romance between Bash and Isla. So this is kind of like deep into an alien romance series, but it can be read as a standalone. A lot of my friends have read this as a standalone. I actually read this book first before I went back and read the other books in the series. So this takes place on a planet where there are a bunch of human refugees, but there are also other alien species on there as well. And so they want to build a kind of refuge and safe haven for these human women who get illegally taken from Earth. So Bastion here is the Koi Master. He's in charge of a building said safe haven. So all the women are going to help him build. And so they have to kind of collect as many materials as possible, like rocks and stuff like that on the planet, to build the structure. Bash is in charge of kind of bossing them around and being their leader and telling them what to do. And he is so sick of these human women. This is a Grumpy Sunshine romance, by the way. So Bash is very grumpy. He's also this alien creature on the front. I forgot to mention that he is an alien. He doesn't like these people. These human women, they complain a lot. They want to take a lot of breaks. They don't have the same work ethic as him. And so he's just so sick of them. But then he ends up meeting Isla, who is a new human woman on the settlement. And he is totally into her and like obsessed with her. And is like, why? Why am I obsessed with this human woman? I don't like humans. Like, no, this shouldn't be happening. I need to stop. But he just can't help himself because Isla is such a catch. She's such a little ray of sunshine. Isla is also an amputee, so she doesn't have her arm from the elbow down on one of her arms. And her work ethic is so amazing. And that's one of the things that Bash really admires about her, is how hard Isla is able to work with one arm, like carrying these rocks, because all the human women are complaining while they're carrying rocks with two of their hands. And here's Isla, totally persevering through everything, not being a complainer, and just carrying rocks with one arm. I really love this one. If you want a good alien grumpy sunshine romance rack, you have to pick this one up. For historical romance, I have When the Earl Met His Match by Stacey Reed. Hugh and here is our hero, and he is the future Earl of Albury, and he is in need of a wife. So guess what he does? He puts an ad in the newspaper in need of a wife. Lady Phoebe, our heroine in here, ends up seeing said ad and is like, that is ridiculous. And so she basically writes the address back that the ad is a part of, like writes the letter to the person and is like, just so you know, like this is ridiculous. You're not gonna find a good upstanding woman from a newspaper ad. And she also just wants to know what kind of man would do such a thing. And the two of them get in kind of like a letter correspondence where they banter back and forth through these letters, not knowing who the other person is. And then Lady Phoebe gets in a little bit of a bind, and so she has nowhere else to turn to. So she ends up like walking up on the doorstep of Hugh's home, not knowing who Hugh is, and in need of his help. This happens at the beginning of this book, but they get kind of in a marriage of convenience. They get married to help each other out in certain situations. Hugh is our character who is disabled. He is speechless, so he does not speak. And so the heroine and Hugh are really trying to learn how to communicate to the best of their abilities. She learns his signs and everything. Like, it is It's really cute. I really love this one. Last one that I would love to mention is also a historical romance. This is How to Entice an Enchantress by Karen Hawkins. This is the third book in the series, but you can totally read it as a standalone. It's totally fine. The only commonality is that each book in the series is about this godmother who is a duchess who is trying to set up her three goddaughters during house parties she puts on, which is iconic. I love house parties. And so this duchess is hilarious. She has like six pugs that are in her house that also meddle in these characters' love lives. Like, it is classic. I love it. This is about Lord Kirk and Dahlia. They actually had a little bit of something going on, but the hero said some things that weren't the nicest. And it's kind of like the iconic Pride and Prejudice moment where Darcy is proposing to Elizabeth in the rain. And he says some not nice things when he's proposing to her. And she's like, why would I marry you after all of the things you just said? And so there's that kind of moment in here. Dahlia and Lord Kirk are actually neighbors and they bump into each other one day and they start talking about books. And Lord Kirk is like, oh my gosh, this woman has a lot of the same interests that I do. Let's just get married because I'm in need of a wife. I'm in need of an heir. And so I feel like she'd be an amazing friend and just someone to like be my next wife, because he is actually a widower. He's already been through love. He's already loved a wife. And so he's like, I don't need to go through that pain and heartbreak again of losing the love of my life. So I'm just gonna marry a friend. And so when he proposes to her, he says some not nice things. And so he enlists this duchess's help to get Dahlia to marry him. She puts on this house party in order to get the two of them together. But Dahlia's kind of like having none of it because Kirk really hurt her feelings. The reason why his wife passed was because he was in a boating accident with her. I think there was an explosive on the boat that they were on and it went off and his wife ended up dying, and it left Lord Kirk with scars all over his body and his face and with some chronic pain. And I believe he now walks with a limp and he has to use a cane to get around now. So this is a book simply about Lord Kirk trying to woo the woman who he wants to be his life partner, and then he slowly starts falling in love with her. He claims that he can never marry for love again because he doesn't want his heart to get broken, but he ends up falling for Dahlia anyway. So anyways, there you have it. Those were 10 romance recommendations that have disability and or chronic illness rep in them. Please let me know down below if you've read any of these books or if you plan to. And if you don't feel like commenting any of those things, you can leave me any blue emoji in the comment section down below. But anyways, thank y'all so much for watching, and we'll see y'all soon in my next one. Bye y'all.